Hi, I'm Susan Taylor with Scripps Health in San Diego, California. Please subscribe to our Scripps Health YouTube channel. We've got great videos featuring the latest technology, our stellar doctors, and inspiring patient stories. Having a family, maybe it's part of your life plan, but not now. You're thinking way down the road. So today we're going to talk about birth control. There are many types, and each has its own benefits, side effects, and risks. Which method of birth control is right for you? Joining us to talk about this is Dr. Jonathan Dunn. He is an OBGYN, obstetrician gynecologist with Scripps Clinic in Carmel Valley. Thanks so much for being with us.
Thank you for having me, Susan.
Sure. So birth control has changed a lot in the last 25 years, has it not?
There's been some significant advances over time.
And let's talk about the most common ones. How do they work? How effective are they? What are the risks and what are the side effects? Let's start off with the birth control pill.
So birth control pills, their mechanism of action primarily is that it will help prevent ovulation for women. It also will change cervical mucus, so it makes it harder for the egg and the sperm to come together. There have been changes over time that the dose has decreased significantly. The pills available nowadays may have only 1/15th the amount of hormone that they had when pills were initially introduced.
And how is that better for the patient?
It definitely suggests that it confers less risk, certainly less side effects.
Okay. And then there is a mini pill as well. So that doesn't have any estrogen in it?
So the mini pill is a progesterone-only pill. Technically, it's not quite as effective at preventing pregnancy as the regular combined pill that has the estrogen and the progesterone, but it works well for certain people, and it's very commonly used for people who are postpartum and breastfeeding.
So when you talk about the efficacy, how effective is the birth control pill?
The failure rate for the combined birth control pills is on the order of 4%. And that's in the setting of people who would likely, about 80% of women would manage to get pregnant in a given year if they weren't using anything at all.
Interesting. And so the mini pill, which is only
progesterone.
Right. And so that's for women who can't take estrogen for medical reasons. What would those reasons be?
The mini pill would be indicated for people who have issues with hypertension, migraines with auras, people who have increased risk of having heart attacks, people who have a personal history of blood clots that have formed inside their body.
Interesting.
We wouldn't use estrogen in those circumstances.
Okay. And then what about hormone injections? What are they? How long do they last?
So the injectable form of progesterone lasts for 3 months. Typically, the dosing is every 12 weeks. People can get it between every 10 and 13 weeks. Very effective. It doesn't require anything on the part of the patient to ensure that it's working for them. They just have to remember to come to their appointments.
Any side effects? Any risks?
That particular form of contraception is probably more effective than taking birth control pills. One of the side effects is that it commonly will lead to irregular bleeding or changes in people's menstrual bleeding. Also, the injectable form has a tendency to have sort of a longer echo after people have stopped using it because it takes a while for it to be cleared from their body. So for folks who are hoping to become pregnant shortly after they discontinue birth control, that may not be the best choice.
And now there's a skin patch?
The ortho-ever patch has been around for a while.
Okay.
That patch is really convenient because you don't have to remember to take a pill every day. You just take a patch once a week, usually 3 weeks in a row, then a week off when people would have their period. There are some concerns that the overall dosing with hormones is higher with the patch, and that may lead to increased risk of certain problems like blood clots.
And so how big is the patch and where would you put it?
So the patch is about 1¼ inches on size. You rotate the location. You can put it anywhere on your body other than your breast. You can put it on your arm, on your belly, on your back, on your thighs.
And can you go in the water with this patch?
Yeah, everything you want to do, exercise, swimming, no problem.
Huh. And then there's a progesterone implant.
Yeah, so
show us that one.
the implantable form of progesterone is called Nexplanon. It's about this big. This is a highly effective form of contraception. It goes by the label a long-acting reversible contraceptive. It's good for 3 years.
Oh, wow.
Very popular among young women. Doesn't require any maintenance. For most people, it's very, very minimal discomfort putting it in. They put it in and they forget about it for the next 3 years.
And it's about the size of a quarter?
A little bit bigger than a quarter.
Okay. And then where would you implant it?
So it's going to go on the underside of a person's arm, usually in their non-dominant arm, kind of between their elbow and their underarm.
And are there any restrictions in terms of who can use that one?
You would choose the same thing with other forms of hormonal contraception.
And then what about the IUD?
The IUD is among my favorite forms of contraception for my patients. This is an example of what an IUD looks like. This is a copper IUD. It's among the largest of the IUDs. The other ones are actually a little bit smaller, but it's still pretty small. The IUD is extremely effective at preventing pregnancy, also a long-acting reversible form of contraception. This particular IUD is good for 10 years.
Wow.
And so for people who are looking for excellent contraception, which is essentially maintenance-free, it's compatible with breastfeeding, this is a great choice for essentially all people who don't have a copper allergy.
And there are some IUDs that release hormones and others do not?
The IUDs that don't have hormones, they set up a sterile inflammation of the uterine lining. It leads to extremely effective contraception. The failure rate is a fraction of 1%. That IUD has a tendency initially to give people maybe heavier menstrual periods. The progesterone-containing IUDs, which constantly diffuse a little bit of IUD hormone to affect the uterine cavity, they have a tendency to give people much lighter menstrual periods. So not only do they have very, very effective contraception, typically they also have much lighter periods.
Okay. So now, all of these so far that we've talked about have involved hormones. What if you don't want to deal with hormones, or what if you're done having kids and you want to have permanent birth control? Is permanent birth control really permanent? Let's say you change your mind down the road. We want you to hold this thought. We're going to come back and talk about this a little bit later. What about the vaginal ring?
So the NuvaRing is another one of my favorite forms of contraception for my patients. It's a ring. It's placed vaginally, and the hormones are slowly absorbed through the walls of the vagina. The typical dosing is to put it in for 21 days and take it out for 7 days, so women will have a menstrual period every 28 days. Some things that are really nice about this is that people don't have to remember to take a pill every day. They basically just put the ring in once a month. It also gives people a really low exposure to hormone dosing.
And it's very easy to insert.
I think for most people, very, very straightforward to put in and take out.
And then, and once again, you're showing it in relationship to the size of a quarter, and it's small.
Flexible.
Yeah.
So some people who are worried about, is it going to be uncomfortable? Is it going to be difficult? Generally speaking, people just have to be willing to touch themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And people, in my experience, of people who have used oral forms of birth control who switch to the ring almost never switch back because the dosing is so easy.
Interesting. What about condoms?
So condoms are, everything has its advantages and everything has its disadvantages. Condoms are great not only because they give you the benefit of the contraception, but they also help prevent sexually transmitted infections. And so kind of a double whammy. They are user dependent. You need to be experienced and understand how to put on a condom. Condom always has to be put on before there's any contact. And so it's important to understand how to do that correctly.
And how effective is a condom, let's say, compared to a birth control pill?
So it's pretty user dependent. Certainly there are some people who use condoms their entire life and they never have any contraceptive failures. The condoms can break, they can fall off, they have to be used correctly. Technically, the efficacy, when you look at populations at large, is not as high as with other forms of contraception.
And what about the non-prescription methods? Let's talk about the rhythm method, for example.
So there's a couple things that are not prescription. There's actually products that are available over the counter, so you can go to the pharmacy, you can buy spermicides, there's gels, there's films that you can do for that. For people who have regular periods, there's a certain window in their cycle when they're at their peak of their fertility, and that can help for people who are trying to get pregnant, and it can help for people who are not trying to get pregnant.
And now there's an app for that?
Yeah, there's a lot of apps for that. There's always an app for that,
right? Let's talk about that.
So I recommend my patients who are hoping to become pregnant or hoping to not become pregnant that they track their periods using any one of a number of smartphone apps, some of which would actually send people push notifications to let them know when they're at the peak of their fertility.
What about the risks of ingesting hormones, of ingesting estrogen, progesterone, for decades?
It's a great question. And I think the honest truth is it's difficult to know for sure about risks. There are a couple things that have definitely been demonstrated over time. Strangely, interestingly, women actually have a decreased risk of having uterine and ovarian cancer if they've been on hormonal contraception for at least a decade. As far as breast cancer, most studies would suggest that there's not an increased risk, but if there is, it seems to decrease rapidly once the hormones have been discontinued.
So back in 2014, the American Academy of Pediatrics says that condoms also should be used every time the teens have sex to prevent, to provide protection against sexually transmitted diseases that other forms of birth control don't provide. And to boost chances of preventing pregnancy. What are your thoughts on this?
I think it's a great idea. I think particularly for adolescents, they may have more sexual partners, younger people before they're in a stable monogamous relationship. I think condoms are an excellent idea, both for the added benefit of contraception and for STD prevention.
And what should you do to protect yourself against sexually transmitted diseases?
I think part of that's talking with your partner and understanding their personal history. And I would argue it makes sense to use condoms every time until you find yourself in a monogamous situation.
Let's talk about the HPV vaccine. What is it and who needs to get it?
So it's a great question. Cervical cancer is caused by a sexually transmitted virus, the human papillomavirus. Certain subtypes of the HPV can cause cancerous changes on a woman's cervix. The vaccine is indicated for both men and women because men are the transmitters of the virus. And so it's an excellent idea for people to be vaccinated. The FDA recently increased the age of vaccinations between people all the way up to the age of 45.
So you should, what's the earliest that you should go get the HPV vaccine?
The FDA approved earliest age is 9 years old.
Wow.
Typically women will get it and they're before they become sexually active, so it's routinely offered in pediatrician's office around the ages of 11 and 12 to both boys and girls.
Okay, so we referenced this a couple of minutes ago. Let's come back and talk about this. What if you were done having kids? What about permanent birth control? What is that?
So there's a couple options. There's options for both men and women for sterilization. For women, there is a surgery that you can do where you interrupt a person's fallopian tubes. For men, they can get a vasectomy. The tubal sterilization or tubal interruption procedure is something that's done in the operating room. A vasectomy is typically done in a doctor's office.
And what if you, down the road, say, no, I changed my mind. I actually think I maybe want to have more kids. Is it permanent or is it reversible?
It's designed to be permanent. In certain instances, it can be reversible, although honestly, that doesn't work so well for a lot of people. I think when you're thinking about permanent contraception, you would want to make the decision, are we for sure that we want to do this? Largely because there's still the availability of highly effective but reversible forms of contraception like the IUD.
And then what if you don't want to deal with all the hormones? Talk a little bit more about the alternatives.
Well, under the circumstances, the non-hormone containing IUD is something that is available for almost all patients. It's extremely effective at preventing pregnancy. Once it's placed, there's essentially no maintenance for it. It's a great option. You could also think about barrier methods like condoms.
Are different types of birth control better at different stages in your life?
It's also a great question. The choices that people make does depend largely on their age. For example, using IUDs is really commonly true for folks who have had children, are not sure if they're going to have any more children, but are looking for a long-acting reversible form of contraception before they made the final decision. Certain contraceptives are associated with increased risks as people age, specifically the ones that use systemic hormones. The risk of patients having problems with blood clots, possibly heart problems, increases as women age.
So what would you recommend for someone who's in their 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s?
Honestly, it depends on the person's situation, what their beliefs are, what their values are, and what their plans for future pregnancies are, if they even have them.
So that's the conversation that you need to have with your OBGYN.
I think one-on-one is the best way to go. I think one of the big changes, not only in the formulations of contraceptives, is the sort of patient-centered approach where you want to take into consideration not only how effective and the various options people have, but what their own desires are, what their own reproductive plan is.
And we were talking about different forms of contraception at different stages in your lives. The American Academy of Pediatrics does recommend the IUDs for teenagers.
I think one of the things that's great about the IUD is it's so extraordinarily effective. And so in the setting of people who may not be as diligent with the use of condoms and other forms of contraception, this is sort of a guarantee or maybe more like an insurance policy that people aren't going to have pregnancies earlier than they're planning on that.
Because once again, the IUD lasts for how long?
Depends on the IUD, but the range is between 5 and 10 years.
That's kind of a no muss, no fuss.
It's so easy for so many people, and it works so well. I'm a huge fan.
Any final thoughts, Doctor?
I think probably the one thing that comes to mind is that almost all the things we've been talking about are things that it's contraception for women, and I hope in the next 25 years that we find really good contraceptive options that are things that men can use and takes the onus off women.
Because the only contraception that men can use now is the condom.
We can use condoms and they can have permanent sterilization, and one of them is essentially irreversible and the other one's not so effective.
Thanks so much, Dr. Dunn. If you want more information on birth control, please click on the link or go to scripps.org/videos. Want more critical information about your health? We take care of you from head to toe. Please subscribe to our Scripps Health YouTube channel and follow us on social media at Scripps Health. I'm Susan Taylor. Thanks so much for joining us. It's our mission at Scripps to help you heal, enhance, even save your life.